Hey everyone, in this video, we're going to be talking about the extent of reaction. The extent of reaction is a way of understanding how many steps forward a given reaction has taken. So, for every extent of reaction, we produce the number of moles stated in our balanced stoichiometric equation. If you are looking at this balanced equation here, and we have, say, an extent of reaction of 3, then this means that we will produce 9 moles of our product C. This little squiggle here is called epsilon, and it is a variable most commonly used to denote the extent of reaction. A large benefit to this is that it works for multiple reaction systems. Previously, we were using conversion, and this is still great for single reaction systems. However, in multiple reaction systems, determining which reactant will be the limiting reagent gets much more difficult. So, let's begin with a simple one reaction system example, so you can gain an intuitive understanding, but then we will talk about a multiple reaction system. Let's say that we are observing this general reaction here. 4 moles of A plus 2 moles of B produces 1 mole of C. And let's say that into our batch reactor here, we have 12 moles of A and 4 moles of B. Clearly, we will run out of our B reactant much quicker than our A reactant. Therefore, B is going to be our limiting reagent. To find the extent of this single reaction system, we take our number of B moles at the beginning and subtract from the number of B moles we have at the end. Then, divide this all by the stoichiometric coefficient of B that we needed to create the reaction. Therefore, we have 4 minus 0 divided by 2, which gives us an extent of reaction of 2. Now, we can also use this extent of reaction to solve for the amounts of our other components involved in the reaction as well. So, we write out the equation which I presented earlier and apply our extent of reaction and solve for the amount of A and C at the end of our reaction. Therefore, when the reaction is completed, we will be left with 2 moles of A and 2 moles of our product C. So, the extent of reaction is specific to the conditions of our reaction, i.e. how much reactants we have, and the stoichiometric coefficients of that specific reaction. So, the extent of reaction helps us understand how far our components will react. Now that we are finished with our single reaction system example, let's move on to get a better understanding of how the extent of reaction can help us understand multiple reaction systems. As I stated previously, conversion is not usually an option for multiple reaction systems. Therefore, we need another way of understanding how much all of our reactions will react. So, to better understand this, let's create another arbitrary example, but with 2 different reactions. Although this is a low number of reactions, this method works with any number of reactions. So, let's say that in reaction 1, we have the same reaction as above, and we denote the extent of reaction for this reaction as epsilon 1. And for reaction 2, let's say that we have 3b plus 1c equals 2d. Now that we have defined all of our arbitrary reactions, let's assume that we have a batch reactor with 10 moles of A, 10 moles of B, and 0.5 moles of C coming in. Additionally, we also know that 1.5 moles of D and 1 mole of C are remaining after the reaction is completed. To understand how much each of these 2 reactions will advance, let's create a table here to keep track of all of our values. The extent change here is the number of moles either consumed, which gets a negative value, or produced, which gets a positive value, times the extent of reaction in which it has been involved. This should be more clear when examining the rows of B and C, as they are both involved in reactions 1 and 2. And with this, it should be clear to you as why defining a limiting reagent for multiple reaction systems can be very tricky, especially once you get into systems that have, say, 20 side reactions. Alright, so we need to find 2 independent equations that we can solve for our 2 unknown variables, that is, our extent of reaction for reaction 1 and the extent of reaction for reaction 2. We can use C and D since these 2 equations will only have our desired 2 unknowns. If we used A or B, we would have 4 unknowns, that is the amount of A and B at the end of our reaction, plus our 2 extent of reactions. By selecting C and D, we have 0 degrees of freedom, meaning that our number of equations equals our number of unknowns, and we can solve for both of the extent of reactions through this manner. So let's go ahead and solve for the two extents of reactions. Extent 2 in this example can be solved quickly by dividing 1.5 by 2. Therefore, extent of reaction 2 is equal to 0.75. Now, that number can be quickly plugged in to the first equation and used to solve for the first extent of reaction. This gives us a value of 1.25 for our first extent of reaction. Now that we know these two values, we can solve for the amount of A and B remaining at the end of our reaction period. This can be done by grabbing the values in our table here and creating equations just like we did for C and D. As you can see here, our table is now complete, and our reaction is fully understood. Clearly, the extent of reaction is a powerful tool for multiple reaction systems, and is something that we'll be using quite frequently throughout this course. Thank you for checking out this video, and I hope it helped your understanding of what the extent of reaction is and how it can be beneficial to our understanding of single and multi-reaction systems. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our Patreon to support the channel. However, if you have any comments, questions, or